I'm Bob Klaza. I've been in broadcast industry since my 20s and have an FCC first-class phone and worked at various radio stations in the area, FM radio stations. There are two things that I'd like to talk about. One is FM antennas and review three specific ones that I have with me here. What's an antenna? It's a piece of wire that you take an RF signal and put it into a box. Now, one of the simplest antennas for FM is like a car radio mast antenna, a whip. If you have a piece of coax coming out of the back connector of the radio that's about 30 inches long, 31 to be exact, but 30 inches long, and then a wire that extends up from the fender that's 31 inches long, it turns out that's a perfect match impedance-wise for the signal, the cable, and the antenna input. And you get the lowest loss possible because you have a perfect match all the way through. You get a maximum signal transfer. However, not too many people have that in their home. Usually they end up with the classic twin lead T antenna. They come with every tuner, their packages in every box. Someone in China's making them by the gazillions, and anybody that sells you a tuner throws one in the box and out it goes. These are very effective, they're very inexpensive, but do they really work well? Well, you have to tack them up, you have to put them somewhere, and then you have to have the thing attached to two terminals on the back of your tuner. It's balanced, which is to fight noise interference from ignition systems or microwave ovens or stuff like that. But it's kind of primitive. There's another variation of this, and that's an aluminum mast antenna, that's a T. And typically, you'd like a coax, like RG6, to go down to your tuner, so you have to have a transformer, though. And this is another little gizzy that can break or, fill with water when it's raining outside if this is an outside antenna. It turns out that this one is actually a straightened out S antenna. And it turns out that if you go to the WineGuard or any other FM antenna manufacturer and you look at the polar pattern for reception of an S antenna, not so much. Even the classic twin T antenna. Everybody seen these?
Turnstile.
Yeah, turnstile. It turns out that this isn't omnipolar reception either. This is more cardioid, because you have one element that's in this direction, one element that, and then there's a piece of, again, the 300-ohm twin lead attaching the two, and you hook up your transformer up here to take your coax down to your receiver. It's not omnidirectional. It's kind of cardioid. There's a notch in the frequency response, or the polar pattern, and again, WineGuard will tell you, they'll give you the chart, and yeah, it's not round. So, what's a guy to do? Well, it turns out that one of our favorite suppliers, Parts Express, had this guy on sale. Now, this is a heck of a lot smaller. It's not 5 feet that way and 5 feet that way. It mounts on a mast, and believe it or not, it even has the F connector output right in as a permanent feature of it. So one less part to break. However, is this omnidirectional? I don't know. They don't have any data whatsoever that comes with it other than F connector output, and it's for FM. But if you look at the length of this, each one of these ends is about 28 inches long. So, in order to get something that is truly omnidirectional, put it like that. Now, this thing will pick up anything 360 degrees with equal intensity, with equal ability to receive the antenna.
Or it's like receive a car antenna, right?
It's like a car antenna, but this is actually... a car antenna, if you put it, obviously, in the middle of the roof of your car, you have a ground plane, and that effectively doubles the signal capture in the quarter of the wavelength that you have sticking above the roof. This effectively doubles the wavelength, but without a big metal, sheet metal ground plane. And you hang this in the attic, you run the lead down to the basement where I have my FM tuner, and it works like a champ. Now, however, I'm an engineer. I want measured data. So what I did...
Do all the radio stations transmit horizontal and vertical?
Actually, they transmit circular. So they transmit everything, and it turns out that FM transmitting antennas have been circular for 25, 30, 40 years. They were novel at first because, for example, some FM stations I know had vertical antenna bays and then horizontal antenna bays, and they fed them both with the same RF signal, splitting them up to all the different bays. Because they want vertical for the car radio antenna. But is that vertical? No, that's horizontal. But again, circular polarization, where the thing is constantly rotating every cycle of the RF wave front coming at you, kills them both, kills two birds with one stone. It does everything.
You want,
yeah, and it also has less susceptibility to multipath in some locations. Notice how I said some locations.
Circular polarization, I think, was popularized when a high percentage of FM receivers in use became mobile.
Yes, that is correct, towards the late 60s and early 70s. Now, let's go to measured data. A couple days ago, I hooked up three antennas, the turnstile, the circular, and the single vertical dipole in the attic, one at a time. The others were far away. Ran it down to the brand new HD Digital Sangean HD T20 tuner that I just got a couple weeks ago, and did a station scan with rating. I rated the station, rated the quality of the reception on each of the 200 kilohertz spaces throughout the band, from zero, no signal, 100% noise or muted, rating one, signal present but not intelligible, rating two, noise and signal appears on the station, rating three, signal intelligible with static in the background, rating four, must adjust volume to hear the noise, rating five, no noise, full stereo FM. Quick question.
Is there a signal strength meter in the tuner?
Yes, there is, but it's like three or four segments, so it's very coarse. It's very primitive. Doing a scan of all the frequencies from 87.7 to 107.9, I took the ratings of the received signals and added them up to get a score. The turnstile actually finished the worst of all three. It achieved a score of 247. The circular guy, this thing, far smaller, 251. But wait a minute, that's not such a big difference. That's like one station, a couple of stations getting a 2 rather than a 1. The total number of clear stations was 36. So the number of received clear stations was the same. However, the best performing antenna of these three was this guy hung vertically. If you do this, you wipe out any of the stations that the axis line is pointed to. It's most sensitive this way and that way. It's a dipole. So this got 252. Okay, 252, 251, 247. Guess what? They all work just peachy keen fine. Any questions?
Did you check the cheap antenna?
I wouldn't bother.
One quite last question on the antennas. Do you have like a Yagi or anything, like multi-element?
Okay, here's the deal. I determined that this had the best numeric score of all. Could I do better with a Yagi and a rotor? But that's another world, cost and complexity-wise, that, frankly, I don't want to get into. However, Joe Prehler has a very slick idea.
I think it's your idea anyway. So.
Well, no, but he actually made it work. He actually did one. You take this, and you take, there's a couple wires there. You put a transformer here with a coax. You put a transformer here with a coax, and you scan through. Wait a minute. I get one station when I check with this element, but I get another station on the same frequency if I go to this element. Because if one station's there and one station's there, this one won't pick up that one, but this one will, and vice versa. So really, there's a possibility to maybe even get a higher reception score doing that, but that's a project for another meeting.
That's switching out either one.
You have to switch the coaxes with a selector switch. Okay, and you have to have two down leads. More complexity, but not a rotor or a Yagi. Yes, Dennis.
There's a lot of other tricks you can do if you really want to play with this. You know, Tam's been doing that all along.
Oh, yes.
You can use vertical polarization. You can take two of those and stack them vertically.
Put them
in a phasing harness with one.
Yes.
And then you can get another 6 dB or more of gain out of it and still be omnidirectional, which is nice.
You're absolutely correct. But that's more complexity again. You know, and more space, more height. And, you know, this is 5 feet high. If you want to stack them up going there, you have to have 10 feet.
Why do you be ridiculous when you can be impossible?
Sure. Fair enough. One of the key things for FM reception is just put it up as high as you can get it. That's the key thing. Height. The higher the better.
Line of sight, right?
Line of sight is good, yes.
I had a high-end channel master putter rotor.
Yeah.
And I was picking up Youngtown stations.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's very common if you have a Yagi with a rotor. That's
FM?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
In Ohio.
Yeah.
That's
WGTE 90.5.
At times it was coming
in. I listen to that
Toledo.
Brighton.
I listen to that all the time.
And where's that located?
Toledo, Ohio.
Okay.
WGTE 90.5. Yeah, well, Lansing, that's about an equal distance in the other direction.
I had a large FM Yagi that I would manually rotate. I got Barberton, Ohio, and all the rest of those things as well. As a matter of fact, I probably have done some of the best DXing you've ever heard of. I actually picked up a station in Miami, Florida, when I lived in El Paso, Texas.
That's Troposphere.
On FM. Okay.
Any other questions?
How did the Sanjin compare with the Sony?
That's the next segment, and that's a perfect segue. Thank you, Arnie.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.